Welcome to Lunch with the Lord. I'm Pastor Mark. We're in Nehemiah chapter 2 this lesson. We're going to be starting at verse 1. But before we begin, Jeremiah 15, 16, thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. Now, verses 1 through 8 of Nehemiah chapter 2 are where Nehemiah requests to the king Artaxerxes to go back to Jerusalem. So this is Nehemiah's request to the king. So in verse 1 it says, and it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Now it says here that it was the month Nisan. And as we saw a few lessons ago, that Hanani comes to Shushan, where Nehemiah is, in the month Chislu. And we said that the month of our month of December. And now it says here that Nehemiah goes before the king in the month Nisan. And Nehemiah had been fasting and mourning for about 4 months. So the month Nisan here is our like April. So from December to April, Nehemiah is fasting and praying concerning the words that he heard from Hanani, who came from Jerusalem. Now, it says here also in verse 1 that it was in the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king. Now, God specifically had this date written down because this is when the 70 weeks of Daniel begin. It says in Daniel chapter 9, verses 25 to 27, and it says, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to what? To restore and to build Jerusalem, unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the walls, even in troublous times. So this here, you can read this and think nothing of it. But when Nehemiah writes down that it was the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king, that this is the beginning now of Daniel's 70 weeks. And it says also that wine was before him, and I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. The king was sitting down to a meal, and Nehemiah would taste test any wine or any kind of drink that was brought to the king. Nehemiah has a dangerous job, and this job allowed him to be in the king's presence a lot. And it is not without question that Nehemiah and the king would, to some degree, become friends. And to be made, I'm sorry, to become friends. And the king may even ask Nehemiah his opinion on decisions that would be made in the kingdom. Without having an official title, Nehemiah could have been one of the king's advisors. I mean, Nehemiah was a cupbearer. And Nehemiah taste tested anything that came to the king, just to make sure that, you know, was no poison. So Nehemiah had a dangerous job. And Nehemiah spends time with the king. And The king gets to know him. He gets to know the king. And it's not without reason that the king would sometimes say, you know, Nehemiah, listen, I got these advisors here and they're telling me this and they're telling me that. Listen, what do you think? What do you think I should do on this? Or what do you think should be done in this situation? It's not without reason to think that the king wouldn't sometimes ask Nehemiah his opinion on things. And in a sense, Nehemiah was somewhat of, although he was a cupbearer, he would be seen also somewhat as an advisor to the king. It is not known why Nehemiah did not go to Jerusalem 12 years earlier with Ezra. But maybe he thought that he could in some way help the Jews by staying behind. It was either that, maybe Nehemiah was too young. We don't know about Nehemiah's family situation. We don't know, again, we don't know how old Nehemiah was, but why he didn't go with Ezra back to Jerusalem 12 years earlier, no one knows. But ultimately, we see that in the end, it was God's hand. It was God's hand in the decision for Nehemiah to stay in Jerusalem. Maybe he had no choice to stay. Maybe he had to stay for whatever reason. But it was God's plan for Nehemiah to stay in Shushan to be with the king and to be his servant. Whether Nehemiah had the position of a cupbearer when Ezra returned, when Ezra went to Jerusalem or not, we don't know. It's possible that Nehemiah was young and it was that Nehemiah got this position of being cupbearer after Ezra had left and gone to Jerusalem. Verse 2. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is your countenance sad, seeing that you are not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid. Now, any employee of the king was expected to be happy and content with being in the presence of the king. But Nehemiah is not only expressing sadness in his presence, but Nehemiah is about to request to quit his job with the king. Both of these were very serious issues. So serious that Nehemiah was very afraid. We do not know if his life was in danger, but it's possible that it was. It's possible, again, we don't know the rules and regulations of what meant to be a cupbearer. If you wanted to, you know, go to the king and say, sorry, king, you know, I've done this now for 5 years and I don't feel like risking my life anymore for you. I've got a wife and kids, or I want to do my own thing now. We don't know what the rules and stipulations of being a cupbearer were. But because it says that he was sore afraid, he was afraid because, in a sense, you weren't supposed to be sad in the king's presence. I don't know if there was a written rule on it or not, probably not. But you were expected to be in the presence of the king, that it was a joyous time, a time of happiness. And yet Nehemiah goes this day, he goes and he's sad in the presence of the king, and the king sees it. And now Nehemiah is afraid. Verse 3, and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, lies waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Now, although the actual city of Jerusalem is not mentioned by Nehemiah, yet the king must have had some idea which city that it was that he was talking about. I don't think the king would hire someone to be his cupbearer without doing some kind of background check on the guy, right? In verse 5 and in verse 7 is when Nehemiah mentions about arriving or going to Judah. And Nehemiah approaches the king in such a way that his request is taken as a personal request, not as a political move. So Nehemiah is sad, and the king sees it, and he requests, "Why are you sad? You're not sick. I know that. So why are you sad?" Why shouldn't I be sad? Nehemiah says, "The house, my father's, the city is in ruins, and it's a shame. I want to go back and build." He didn't do this as a political thing. He did it as a personal. He approached the king as, "This is a personal request by me to go back to Jerusalem and see what I can do about building the city up." Verse 4. "Then the king said unto me, 'For what do you make your request?' So I prayed to the God of heaven." Now, the king realizes that Nehemiah wants to make a request. So he asks him, what does Nehemiah want? Now, the great fear that was in Nehemiah's heart must have been a little bit relieved when the king asks him for his request. It must have been a breath. Whew, I'm not going to die, right? Well, we don't know if it was, you know, punishment of death to leave being a cupbearer or not, or being sad in his presence. We don't know that. But it must have been a great relief when the king said, "What do you request? What do you want me to do for you?" Nehemiah now wants to respond to the king in honor and in respect, but he wants to do it in such a way that the king will be lenient toward him. Therefore, he prays quickly to God to give him the right words to say and to move also upon the king's heart. So Nehemiah prays this quick prayer. It might have only been a couple of words. "Father, bless," in his heart. He's not saying it out loud in front of the king, but in his heart, he prays a quick, probably real short sentence prayer. "Father, do something here. Help me to get back to Jerusalem." And so, you know, there are times in our life when we don't have time to pray long prayers about certain things. They have to be quick. The situation is such that they're quick. And you know, God hears them and God honors them. Our heart is humble before him, and he sees quick prayers. Our prayers shouldn't always be quick. No, we need to spend time with our Father. But there are times when quick prayers are needed because of the situation. And so we pray this quick prayer. "Father, just bless this time, bless this king to give me what I'm asking for." That's it. Amen, right? Prayers don't always have to be long. As long as it's from a humble heart seeking God's will. And you know, he prayed, and because he wanted, not only did he want God to answer his request, but he wanted God to move upon the king's heart to give him his request. And verse 5, and it says here, verse 5 says, "And I said unto the king, if it please the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, that you would send me to Judah, unto the city of my father's sepulchres, that I may build it." Now, this brings up the portion of scripture in Ezra chapter 4, verses 7 through 24, where the Jews actually did start building the walls, but opposition sprang up during King Artaxerxes' reign. And they wrote a letter, the enemies of the Jews wrote a letter to King Artaxerxes. Now, after reading their letter, the king made a search for information on the city of Jerusalem. And because of what the king found out, the king stopped the Jews from building. So it seems, if you read Ezra 4, verses 7 through 24, when I did the book of Ezra, I didn't go over these verses of scripture in my studies on the book of Ezra, because that portion of scripture had nothing to do with the time period of Ezra. It had to do with Nehemiah's time period, or a different time period. But now we see that if you read Ezra 4, 7 through 24, you're going to see that it seems that the children of Israel, at some time after the temple was built, they did begin to build the wall. But the enemies came and they wrote letters to the king. The king made a search of the city, found out it was a rebellious city. You can read those verses. It says it right there. And the king says, go and stop them from building the wall. So they stop. And it's in the wall, the building of the wall had been stopped from that time until this time here. It's possible that according to Ezra 4, verse 12, that the Jews which came up with thee could be referring to Ezra's return in about 458 BC, which was only about 12 to 14 years before. Now, if this is true, or if this decree by Artaxerxes was some only about 8 to 14 years ago, then this decree would be somewhat remembered by Artaxerxes. So it really would take a move of God to turn the king's heart in the opposite direction and to let Nehemiah build the walls. So what he's saying here is that if this king, King Artaxerxes, remember, this king that we're dealing with here in the book of Nehemiah is Esther's stepson, the son of King Artaxerxes, her husband. So if this king, the stepson, if he made the decree for the Jews to stop building the wall, well, then when Nehemiah comes along and he wants to build the wall, it would somewhat be in this King Artaxerxes' mind that he would remember them stopping, because it was only 12, 14 years ago that the king made the decree. If this king made that decree, but we don't know. We don't know how many years before the Jews were starting to build the wall and they were stopped. Now, according to Ezra chapter 4 and verse 21, it would take another decree by the king to reverse this. So, if this king, King Artaxerxes, Esther's stepson, made this decree to stop building the wall, then it would take another decree by the same king to start building the walls all over again. In Ezra chapter 2 and verse 19, it says, "Will you rebel against the king?" This could be referring to an earlier decree made by Artaxerxes. Now, the King Artaxerxes of Ezra chapter 4 is believed to be, Esther's stepson. Now, if this is true, then it seems that this king did not feel the same way about the Jews as his father did, Esther's husband. It didn't take long for the good feelings about the Jews to wear off. Remember the story of Esther and Mordecai? So Esther's husband, which was King Artaxerxes, he was all for the Jews. And Mordecai was second in command. And King Artaxerxes gave the Jews great freedom in the land of Persia. And so now, if his son is the one who stopped the building of the wall, again, the freedom that the Jews had didn't last very long. The son, King Artaxerxes' son, he didn't feel the same way. If his son was the one that stopped the building, then it means his son didn't feel the same way about the Jews that his father did, Esther's husband. We're going to continue on in verse 6 next lesson. But until then, walk with the Lord. I know he walks with you.